Welcome back to Buckeye Bigfoot. Hello, everyone. Well, I hope this Friday night finds everyone out there safe, well, and well-stocked on the snackage. Because I know while you were all out there running that heavy smash-mouth offense at the store to get that toilet paper, that you all remembered to get the snacks while you were there, didn't you? I'm sorry to say, though, that tonight I only have one Ohio encounter for you. We're getting pretty low on those. I'm getting them from everywhere else, which I absolutely love, but we're really low on the Ohio encounters. So, get your snacks ready, because we're about to dive in, and there ain't no time to lose. Hi, I'm writing to tell you about the two different times that I saw a Bigfoot and the things that happened around here that I think was a Bigfoot, too. We live out on Hanley Road in Mansfield. Now, I don't want to say east or west because my husband is already mad and would be mad even more if he knew I was telling this at all. Although Mansfield area is full of houses and people, there are lots of parks all around it. Out where I live, there's mostly farm fields. Most are separated by little strips of trees, and most of those connect together somewhere. So who knows where this thing is sleeping? And I do think it's sleeping out there. We have seen one twice in the last 8 years. That ain't a lot, but I think they're living out there somewhere close for sure. The first time I saw it, we were driving home from shopping. It was around 7 p.m., and it was in June. Now, at that time, it was still light out. We had just turned on to another road that leads to our road when we saw something up ahead. It was moving in the ditch way down the road. Now, that road has fields on both sides, and we could see pretty far down the way. We slowed down because we didn't want whatever it was to come out and us hit it. But all of this happened real quick, quicker than I can tell you. We turned, we saw this dark brown thing, and then saw that it was walking upright. Right then, it showed us that it wasn't anything we knew. My husband stopped the car. We looked at it as it was just walking down the drainage by the road. I asked, "What is that?" And my husband said, "Heck, I don't know." We stared at it for a little more. And then it was still a way down the road, and then my husband decided to honk the horn. I asked him later, "Why did you do that?" He said, "I don't know. I just wanted it to go away. I wanted it to move." After he honked the horn, the thing stopped and turned its whole body around and looked at us. The whole body. Not just the top. The whole body. It had actually turned around in reverse direction to where it could have just started walking directly to us. The setting sun was behind it, so we had a good outline of its shape. We both saw that it was very tall, even standing in the runoff depression by the side of the road. I don't know how deep that ditch is, maybe a foot. It isn't very deep, but me and my husband can't agree on the height of the thing because of that. I say it was at least 7 feet tall, even standing in the ditch, and he says standing in the ditch it was less than that, maybe six and a half. We just can't agree. It didn't come near us, though. It turned back around after a moment and then moved off into the field further away from the road, moving on a slight diagonal. We waited there sitting in the car till it was pretty far gone into the field away from the road, and then we drove on down the road. But we kept our eyes on it till we couldn't see it anymore. My husband thought right away that what we had seen was a Bigfoot. I didn't think they were in Ohio. I didn't even think they were real at all, anywhere. But we talked about it, and he showed me a lot of things on the internet and some things we found in books. We talked about it and agreed that was what we saw. And then after a while, it just went out of our minds, and we forgot about it. But in 2017, we were getting ready to put an addition on to the back of our house. During that time, there was a lot of heavy machinery there, and we were getting the ground regraded in the back part of the area of the house. At that time, they were working by hand near the foundation, but the rest of the ground had already been flattened and was devoid of all grass. So when it rained that one night, there was lots of mud, and then the next morning, there were tracks in the mud. They came from the east side right up to the back of the house. Now, my husband has hunted for years. He knows how to track and how to read tracks. He had never seen these kinds of tracks before, he said. And when he followed them through, he said the prints had come straight up to the back of the house. They stood at the kitchen window, then walked along the back of the house to the one corner, turned around, and then came right back to the kitchen window. And he said that the tracks were overlaid several times there at the kitchen window, and he believed that it had been standing out there for a while. Now that shook me quite a bit, because our kitchen window looked straight through to the living room from that part outside. Also, the kitchen window from the ground outside is 7 feet tall, so not easy to look into. From standing there at the window, you can see to the end of our L-shaped couch with the recliners in the living room. And that is actually where my husband sits. That's his end of the couch. Now, the night before, the night that it was raining, that is, we had sat up really late watching movies. But we never heard anything. And my husband said he didn't have any weird feelings while he was sitting there, like someone was staring at him. We neither one had any inkling. And I think about all the times I walked into the kitchen over and over, and I didn't always turn on the light because I could see well enough to get what I needed. We thought for sure that it was what we had seen years ago. So my husband got rid of the prints before the workers came back Monday morning. Then, when it was all done and we were doing the landscaping ourselves, all the hostas I bought had been pulled out of their containers and had been eaten, roots and all. Now, deer might mow down the plants, but they don't pull them out of the containers, seemingly knock all the dirt off of them, then toss the plastic container away and eat the whole plant. Now, I have no proof that it was a Bigfoot, but I don't know what else it would have been, and it happened all around the same time. Not long after that, our son brought two of his out-of-state friends home with him from a break at college since his friends couldn't make it home. They were all sitting out back one night, just doing what boys do. We have a metal fire pit that's set out on an empty cement pad that once was used for a shed. And that sits some distance from the back of the house, and it sits on the east side of the property. Now that's where they were sitting with a fire, and then they said it sounded like a woman screaming on the other side of the property somewhere in the trees. That scared them. They came in and told us about it. We had faintly heard it in the distance while we were watching TV, but inside it didn't sound like a woman screaming to us. We didn't think anything of it, and we just thought it was them out there goofing around and being young men. But they said it wasn't. And they all three looked spooked, and they didn't want to go back out that evening. So for what it's worth, I did believe them. My husband went out just into the yard with a flashlight, and he shined it all around, but the flashlight was small and not very powerful, and he didn't really see anything. He came in, and then about an hour later, we started hearing strange howling noises. We didn't know what those were either, but my husband said, "No one is going back out there tonight." And there was no argument from any of us. We all got the chance to see what it was the next day. We were sitting outside after having breakfast, and we were just talking about what it was we were going to do that day, when suddenly one of my son's friends started poking him in the shoulder and was pointing across the yard towards the trees. We all looked, and we could see a dark figure standing by some of the trees that wasn't too far from the fire pit. That's 30 yards from the house, in case you're wondering. We all saw the creature. It was just standing there, looking at us from behind a tree. Then it started going back and forth from one side of the tree to the other, like it was playing a weird peekaboo game with us. I also do not think, and did not think at the time, that it was the same one that we had seen a couple years before. This one wasn't as tall than the other one we saw. But we did all agree that the one we saw was about 6 feet tall, shaggy and hairy looking, with dark brown fur, almost black. It was wide-shouldered, and the shoulders were not sloped like most humans. We could all see that. One of the boys said that it looked blocky and square. Then suddenly it just went back further in the trees, like it didn't like us looking at it. I'm not sure it knew we were looking at it, but it just felt like it knew, if you know what I mean. Well, that was the last that we saw of it. We haven't seen any prints or anything since. We haven't heard a howl, though we have been listening. And my husband doesn't trust anyone, and he's very paranoid, and he doesn't want us to tell anyone about this. So please, please, please don't say my name. Thanks a lot, Mrs. Mansfield. All right, everyone. Well, recently a submitter mentioned in her encounter, she made mention of the Minerva Monster. And after that, I had several different people email me and ask me about it, especially those overseas. So for those of you that don't know, the Minerva Monster put Ohio on the Bigfoot map, if you can say that. And to my knowledge, and I'm not aware of any other encounter in Ohio that is so well documented and has been witnessed by so many people. Now, I thought about recapping this historical story for you, but I don't think that I could possibly do this story justice. There is so much eyewitness information. The timeline is not a single event or even a single day. The event was ongoing, and numerous people saw the creature. Local law enforcement believed something was really going on, and they had their own moments. Now, if you're interested in the Minerva Monster, there's so much information online, and there is also a very good documentary that I'll link to above and at the end of this video, and I'll link to it in the description below. I also want to say that it is available on Amazon Prime if you have that. But let me be clear, I'm not associated with the people that made this documentary. I'm not backing anyone or anything like that. But it's the only piece I've found that has the actual people involved telling their story, which, after all the sensational coverage that the incident received at that time, they really didn't talk about it much after that, that I can find. And for you to know, this actually happened in August 1978. So there weren't a lot of, there were no internet interviews or anything like that around. So it's kind of hard, other than some newspaper reports, to find what they really had to say about it. And they suffered a lot of grief and a lot of heartache from the exposure that they got. So to hear their story straight from the horse's mouth, so to speak, well, I think the documentary is worth it for no other reason than that. All right, everyone. Well, I'm sorry to say that's all I have for you tonight. Like I said, I'm low on Ohio encounters. But I am getting a lot of encounters from everywhere else, which I love. So keep them coming. But the Buckeye encounters are getting sparse, so forgive me if they're a little short on Friday nights. Now, if you have had an encounter and maybe you want to talk about it, you'd like to do an interview, be sure to shoot me an email and let me know that as well, and we can get a talk about it. Well, that's it, folks. I'm all done for tonight. I'm Nance Warren, and I'll be putting the sass into Sasquatch until we meet up again, and you guys are the Sasquad, and you're out there doing your sassy stuff, too. So until we meet again, always remember, absence of proof is not proof of absence. Thanks for listening, everyone. Have you had an encounter with the King of the Forest? If so, drop me an email at contact@buckeyebigfoot.com and tell me all about it. Then I'll share it with everyone.